Welcome to the Classical Gabfest, a weekly discussion about the ever-changing world of classical music. I'm your host for this week, Tiffany Liu, and with me as always are Kensho Watanabe and William White. This week we'll take a look at the orchestral recording industry in Eastern Europe and how it recently intersected with right-wing politics here in the U.S. Then we'll open up the mailbag and respond to some listener feedback. And finally, we'll discuss concerning news from the Mariinsky Theater about the COVID outbreak earlier this summer and the tour that went forward in spite of it. But first, we'd like to start with our prelude segment. So, Will, what do we have today?
This week, we'll be playing a round of everyone's favorite game, Two Truths and a Lie. Okay, here's how this works. I have chosen three musical excerpts, all ostensibly by the same composer. But, in a sinister ploy, I have in fact chosen one excerpt that is not by this composer at all. My co-hosts will listen to these three excerpts and try to discern which gives lie to the following statement. This week's excerpts are all by Antonín Dvořák. But before we get to the excerpts at hand, let's discuss what makes Dvořák sound like Dvořák. What do you guys think? What are you going to be listening for?
Dvořák stylistically is kind of hard to pin down in that, one, we immediately think about the folksiness of it, right? Using Czech folk songs and even delving into some American folk songs later on in his life. But at the same time, he had a period in which he was very much a Wagnerite. And then he and Brahms also had a very close relationship in that Brahms was kind of served as his mentor. So it's not necessarily just, you can't just grasp at, oh, whatever sounds folksy sounds Dvořák, because I think there's a little bit more layers of complexity there.
He's a supremely good melodist. I mean, if you hear one of his melodies in his most iconic pieces, you can hear it just once and walk away singing it. There are so many melodies that he's written like that. You know, I remember back in high school when I was, you know, being kind of geeky and uninformed about these things, when I first realized that the adjective Dvořák-y could become a thing. And I don't know what exactly I meant, but I did know that when I heard like a string quartet of his on the radio, which he has several of, which I don't know thoroughly, right? Like there's many that are in, first of all, very far off keys that are very difficult to play, and which I think convinces me that like why they don't get played more often anyway, even though they're amazing. But there's a way that, you know, the kind of triadic weaving together of upper voices to undergird really songful melodies, I think that's a feature of his. And then he's also going to be identifiable by a lot of, I mean, we'll use folksiness as a sort of catch-all term, but there's a couple rhythms. I think he loves the two against three kind of, you know, hemiola merging back and forth between duple and triple meter. Yeah, and then there's a couple orchestral colors, which I think of as his as well. Obviously, the one that comes to mind immediately is the English horn solo in the second movement of Dvořák's Ninth Symphony, which plays the main theme that we recognize from that movement. So those are some of the things that I think that I'll be listening for.
Okay, well, I think that that's all going to serve you very well. So we have three clips today, and these are all voice with orchestra.
It's not going to be easy.
Yeah, Will is using one of his like actual like repertoire knowledge advantages against the two of us, because Will has a foot in the choral / vocal world that I think that I certainly don't have.
Well, we'll see how you do. I've got high expectations here. All right, here is clip number one. And here is clip number two. And finally, here is clip number three.
This is hard.
All right, guys. There are your three clips, ostensibly all by Antonin Dvorak. But, you know, the name of this game implies...
that you're a liar.
That's might be. So what do you think? Tell us your thought processes.
Oh, boy. This is really difficult because I mean, you know, just... based off of the things that we've talked about, kind of triadic harmonies with a very songful character about them, and then this dance-like rhythm sometimes that comes up. I mean, I hear instances of all of those things in all of them, and I'm going to actually probably need a second to collect my thoughts. Kensho, what are your first impressions?
With almost complete certainty, I can say that probably the second one is definitely Dvorak. There was one like harmonic twist that happened in the beginning that really reminded me very much of Dvorak's writing. And then also, I think the main kind of theme or motif that we hear is Dvorak 8.
It's Dvorak 8, right?
Symphony number 8 in the third movement, the trio of the scherzo. It's almost exactly the same theme. No for no.
It has a different cadence at the very end, but it is the melody starts out the same for the first like 7 or 8 bars or something.
Right. So for maybe this will be Instagram content, but we both smiled at that moment. So we instantly recognized something there.
Well, and then Kensho was like raising his eyes when the cadence ends a little bit differently.
I do eyebrow conduct a lot. So I'm going to just rule out 2 and then 1 and 3. It's tough to say. I was drawn toward the third excerpt being more Dvorak-y because of the woodwind writing, you know, with the woodwinds kind of doubling the voice. That kind of reminded me of just the way that Dvorak writes for winds. But I don't know, it's a coin flip for me between 1 and 3.
I'm on the same page. I mean, you know, the thing that caught my ear was the thing that I identified from Dvorak's 9th Symphony, which is the English horn color that's kind of in there, and going downwards. I mean, I think that if I had heard that kind of isolated on the radio, that would have been the moment I was like, oh, that's probably Dvorak. I was able to find fewer instances in the first excerpt that I thought like were immediate snaps to me to Dvorak, although there was a key change in there where it flipped from major to minor, I think, where I thought, oh, well, that's very characteristic. I think I'm probably going to go with 1 as the lie.
All right, so Tiffany is locked in with the number 1 being the lie. Kensho, what do you think?
I'm it's strength in numbers. I'm going with Tiffany as well, with 1 being the lie.
And I'm very happy to announce that you are both correct.
Yeah.
Number 1 was the lie. Number 2, as you guys both picked up on, that was a little bit of a gimme. That excerpt comes from an opera called The Stubborn Lovers. And it's a very charming little aria that, yes, in fact, Dvorak reused in his 8th symphony. So I thought that you guys would probably recognize that, although I did think like, well, maybe, you know, since it's sung and it's a little bit different, you know, it might throw you off slightly.
So the opera came first. The opera first, and then it
yes,
was reused.
The opera came first, and he reused the theme later on. The third clip is from Dvorak's Te Deum, which is a piece that he wrote. I believe it was his last piece that he wrote before coming to the United States. And then the first clip, does anybody want to guess who wrote the lie clip?
Janáček?
I was going to go with Suk.
Both very good guesses, because both are other Czech composers. Those, you know, Josef Suk was Dvorak's son-in-law, and then Janáček was even maybe a little bit younger yet, or certainly of that same Suk generation. So they were both a little younger than Dvorak. This is from one of Dvorak's real contemporaries, Bedřich Smetana. This is from an opera called Dalibor. And, you know, it's like you all say, it has a lot of those Czech Dvorak-y kind of elements. To me, it was a little bit more foursquare than what you might get from Dvorak, a little bit less singable. Like, yeah, Tiffany, I totally agree that Dvorak is the king of melody. And even though it was a nice tune, it didn't quite stick, you know.
I was trying to sing it to myself later on. I'm like, I couldn't quite get there.
Right, right. Yeah, exactly. And then you know, the other thing about the third clip, the Te Deum, that I think is Dvorak-y, the little flute solo and going into the little English horn solo, and they're both pentatonic based music, you know, the 5 notes of the black keys on the piano. And that's something that Dvorak really loves too, and it gives his music that folky kind of an aspect. All right, that just about does it for this week's Prelude segment. But before we wrap up, we'd like to put out a call to our listeners. We are planning to do a listener-generated Name That Tune, so we invite you to try and stump us. Check our show notes, where you'll find a link to the form where you can upload a 30-second unidentified piece of classical music for us to try to identify. And with that, we move on to our first topic. Kensho, what do you have for us?
Last week, far-right political provocateur, author, and filmmaker Dinesh D'Souza tweeted out a teaser video for his new film, Trump Card, the movie. The video features Debbie D'Souza, Dinesh's wife, singing a rendition of America the Beautiful, accompanied by the Budapest Scoring Orchestra, with a few scenes from the film interspersed during the teaser. Let's hear a clip.
Oh, beautiful, for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountain majesty.
This peculiar internet offering gives us a chance to discuss the broader topic of the thriving orchestral recording industry in the former Soviet bloc. While this might seem like a rather esoteric topic for some of our listeners, this industry has come to play a surprisingly integral role in the world of video game and film scoring, contemporary concert music, and even in the world of conducting, as these same orchestras are more than willing to provide conducting opportunities for those willing to pay for it. Will, as a composer who has had some of his works performed by some of these and recorded by some of these orchestras, can you launch our discussion in terms of just talking about your experience?
Yeah, in 2016, I did a project for the first time in the Czech Republic, or as it is now known, Czechia. I don't know if all of our listeners know that, but they've sort of like officially changed their name. So I'll probably refer to it as Czechia. But basically, I had a few orchestral pieces that needed a proper recording. I am my own publisher as a composer, and if you're your own publisher, you've got to kind of advertise your music. You know, you want people to know what it sounds like if they're going to buy the sheet music and then perform it. So not everybody's just lining up to record works of some random guy in America who's a composer, where there are like thousands and thousands and thousands of composers. But if you look online, it's pretty easy to find orchestras in the former Soviet bloc in Czechia, Slovakia, Hungary, the former Yugoslavia, where they will gladly play and record your music for a pretty reasonable price. So when I was embarking on this project in 2016, I did some comparison shopping, and I looked at the rates that were available over in Czechia and the rates that were available in the United States. To record 18 minutes of orchestral music and to go to Czechia, to this far eastern town, like in Silesia, near the border with Poland and Slovakia, I ended up spending about $7,000 all told, and that was to get a recording of three different orchestral pieces. When I got quotes in the United States from some recording orchestras in Seattle and Nashville, the price that I was quoted was $21,000. So I ended up spending a third of the price, which included round-trip airfare to Europe and like my train ride from Prague to Ostrava, where this orchestra that I was working with was located. So, you know, the price can't be beat. I should say, too, I wrote about this on my blog back then, and I did a little vlog about this stuff, and we'll link those in the show notes. But, you know, I can understand why somebody like Dinesh D'Souza, if he's trying to make this documentary on the cheap, would take this option. Now, of course, there is a certain irony in that he's making this Trump card the movie, which is all about how, like, Trump is the great American and, you know, Dinesh D'Souza is an Indian guy and his wife is Venezuelan. And so they're like this American story, but, you know, they think that this kind of crazy conservative politics is all great and America, rah, rah, rah. But then they, you know, they don't put their money where their mouth is, I guess. They go over to Budapest.
It's like finding the Made in China tag on the back of MAGA hats, right?
It's exactly the same thing. That's exactly what I was thinking, Tiffany. But it's totally a financial decision. That's why European and American composers and film production companies go east, go to the former Soviet bloc and to Eastern Europe and these countries in Central Europe, too.
Well, do you remember anything about the breakdown of that $7,000? Like, where's the big discount coming from?
The big discount is coming from the lack of parity in currency exchange and from the low cost of life in Eastern Europe. You know, I mean, it's just a cheap place to live. The people don't make very much money there. The orchestral musicians are civil servants because these orchestras are funded by the government. And so there are, you know, there are these charts of salaries. Like, you know, your salary is set in stone by legislation. Yeah, and, you know, the salary doesn't pay for very much. It pays for a very, very bare bones lifestyle, even in a town like Ostrava. So the fact that these orchestras are open for business for Western companies, it's just like, you know, a little money goes a long way there, both for the people who are purchasing the goods and services and those who are then earning the money. Kencho, I want to hear about your experience. You actually did some recording over there. You like played in an orchestra. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so I kind of saw it from the other side. So I was I spent about a month back in 2000 and I think it was the summer of 2006 at the International Festival Music Festival in Pilsen, Czechia. And if you're unfamiliar with Pilsen, if you do like beer and wonder where Pilsner comes from, this is where Pilsner Urquell is brewed, and I've been to that brewery, so shout out to Pilsen, Czechia, for anybody listening over there. And while I was a student at this festival, one of my violin teachers during that time asked some of us if we were interested in doing a, you know, short gig in Prague to do a recording project for a movie that was being made in LA. This movie was called Home of the Brave, and it came out, I think, in 2006, so just shortly after that. If you don't remember it, it's probably because it wasn't very good.
I'm sure it was saved by your performance on the soundtrack, though.
Oh, yes. We definitely contributed a lot to this. So we went. It was like maybe 6 or 7 hours of recording where the recording producers were in L.A. and we were communicating via Skype or whatever means were available back in 2006. And we got paid, I think the equivalent of around $75.
Wow, for 6 hours of recording work?
Right. So you're wondering why it's so cheap to do it over, to record these things over there. It's because, you know, these musicians are not making very much individually from these projects.
And it's interesting that you bring that up about the Skype thing. Most of the time, composers are watching these recording sessions remotely and chiming in. You know, you can text with the producer and then they relay your messages to the orchestra and to the conductor. So it really is, you know, the technology is also allowing this to happen.
And, you know, our dear Debbie D'Souza seems like she was not in Budapest for this recording. It looks like, and you can all look at watch the video, but it seems like the orchestra recorded the kind of accompaniment first, and then she went into the studio to record her vocal tracks over that. So it's not like anybody from the D'Souza camp went over there to kind of, you know, supervise or direct any of the musical portions there either.
I'm curious, do you think that Dinesh D'Souza, you know, in putting together this project, like, did they try to get musicians here? Do you think that that intent was made?
Well, here, let's talk about that for a second. I mean, let's say they did try. Good luck. Why can't orchestras record in this country or be in the same room, you know, for more than 30 minutes? Oh, well, it's because we've had this totally bungled response to the COVID outbreak. It's not in control. It's getting worse. And why is that? Well, I got news for you, folks. It's because of the people who are at the top of the government, who are the very people that Dinesh D'Souza is trying to lionize, the very person that Dinesh D'Souza is trying to lionize in this documentary. So, yeah, I mean, it does have a little bit of that El Cheapo, you know, just let's outsource this. And, you know, we've got the MAGA hats that have the Made in China tag on it. But it's also, even if they had had the money to spend in the United States, they wouldn't have been able to do it because we're not allowed to have these long recording sessions here. So it would have been impossible.
Yeah. And who knows when this recording was made, right? Maybe it was made a year ago before the outbreak. So just to be fair, it might have been the case. What I find really interesting, the distinction we should make about the MAGA hats, because the Made in China hats, the Made in China tags are inside the hat and they're not conspicuous. When you read the tweet from Dinesh D'Souza, it is in the tweet that he says, my wife sang with the Budapest Scoring Orchestra as if it's, you know, my wife sang with the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra, right? I think that's why that ensemble's name is put there, but it's so overt saying, well,
he's banking on cultural ignorance at this point, right? Because how much of the population knows that the Budapest Scoring Orchestra is nothing at all like the Berlin Philharmonic?
Right. It gives it the imprimatur of Europeanness. And I doubt that many people who would have read that tweet would think, oh, why didn't they record in Nashville, where they have, you know, these studio orchestras that are ready to go? Guys, I think that before we leave this topic, we should, like, I don't want our listeners to, like, click on TrumpCardTheMovie.com. I don't want them to even click on this tweet, quite honestly. I don't want them to watch this stupid video. So with that in mind, let's like describe this video a little bit so that our listeners don't have to actually go watch it, even though this might like sort of tempt them to watch how ridiculous it is.
Okay. Well, of course you have the classic shots of vocalists in the studio, you know, singing their heart out. And then you've also got shots of the orchestra recording. But what really just makes me just laugh every time are the shots of what I'm presuming to be scenes from the movie, where they get some really, let's just say it's a Daniel Day-Lewis wannabe, but completely not at all close to an actor of that stature, attempting to play Abe Lincoln, which I assume is what those shots are of Abe Lincoln boarding a train. Again, doesn't look like that was also shot in the States. I don't know. Maybe it's just because we know it's from Budapest that I just put like a whole weird, like Eastern European vibe to everything.
Well, yeah, I wonder where they would have gotten, like, I mean, it is like a pretty pristine reconstruction of a 19th century steam locomotive that they have.
Right. It seems like, and then the scene of Abe Lincoln sitting, what I looks like the end, like the actual engine, not like the seats of a train, but just like in the engine room of the train, you know, contemplating whatever it is. And mind you, the America the Beautiful, I think how many times does it repeat in terms of, it's
at
like
least
a
three.
Number of,
yeah,
at least three times too many.
Yeah, it's like overwrought, like, you know, false, you know, climaxes where you think it's over, but then yet it continues to come back.
Yes, there's always an extra cymbal roll ready to take you into the next key change, up another half step or whatever. Yeah, it's very chintzy arrangement, very hokey. Strange first verse too, as we all remarked on the first time that we watched this.
Yes, so it is, I think, really very much in a minor or sad,
yeah,
dark mode, maybe. Perhaps, you know, hinting at how much of a mess this country is right now.
Right, yeah, right. And then Abe Lincoln is so forlorn about the state of things. And then, you know, as the music changes from minor to major, and of course, Abe Lincoln is deep in thought about what the future holds for our country, that, you know, he knows that in 160 years that this, you know, valiant prince is going to come save it. And then he, like, looks up inspiredly. And then, you know, we see more clips of Debbie D'Souza poorly synced, singing, you know.
Oh, I don't think it was at all synced. I mean, if you look at any of the orchestral stuff, it's not synced at all. It's just like, let's put random shots of people playing music. And they thought that was enough. So,
well, again, they're banking on the fact that no one knows anybody. Can we move on? I feel a little nauseated.
Yeah, I'm just going to wrap this up. I will just wrap this up by saying, please go vote. All right, so that wraps up this topic. But before we move on, we have a bit of homework for our GabFest listeners. Over the next weeks, the three of us are going to be reading Alex Ross's new book, Wagnerism, and we'll be doing periodic mini-segments to talk about what we've read. So if you want to join us on this quest, now would be a great time to acquire a copy for yourself. Next week will be our first installment of the series, and we'll cover the first two chapters of the book, Rheingold and the Tristan Chord. And with that, we'll move on to our second topic. Tiffany, what do you have for us?
Okay, GabFest listeners, I'm really excited for this segment. You've been listening to us for the past 6 weeks, and now it's time for us to listen to you. We've received a ton of great feedback so far, so we're not going to be able to get to everything, but rest assured we do see it all, and we will definitely respond to everything via email or social media, if not actually on the podcast. But we'd like to share with all of you some of the greatest hits that we've gotten so far. So, Will, why don't you take it away here?
All right. Our first comment comes via email from listener Philip. He says, I just finished listening to Classical GabFest number 5. Very stimulating and highly informative to an old fart such as myself, who is still in the pre-Cambrian age of technology. Well, Phil, hopefully from last week's episode, you know that we take farts young and old alike. We're happy to encourage older listeners. Philip then continues, if I were getting married, which fortunately I don't have to after 52 years of stunning success at it, I would love for someone to play at least a part of The Lark Ascending for us. My wife Phoebe and I were once camping in a remote New Zealand valley and saw and heard a skylark sing its way up several hundred feet into the Empyrean. Once in a lifetime. Perspective, congratulations to Kensho. So obviously this is a comment responding to the fact that Kensho is getting married in just a couple of weeks here, and he mentioned this on the podcast a couple weeks ago when he was talking about some music that he had played for a wedding one time, and he was thinking about what music he wanted at his wedding. We got a couple of comments about what Kensho should play at his wedding, and maybe I'll just take the first paragraph of this next one because it's on the same theme. This is from Chuck, who says, I wanted to make a recommendation for Kensho's wedding. When my wife and I got married, we had the first two sections of Bernstein's Make Our Garden Grow performed as a special music section. However, we have talked recently that if we could do it again, we would have Knee Play 5 performed from Glass's Einstein on the Beach. The poetry is perfect for a wedding and the music is sublime. So Kensho, what's your reaction? What do you think of Ray Vaughan Williams' Lark Ascending, Bernstein's Make Our Garden Grow, or Philip Glass's Einstein on the Beach? That would make for an interesting wedding playlist there.
You know what? I'm just going to go ahead and just put that all on my playlist for the wedding and see what happens, see what comes out. This is great. I mean, no one suggested that we do Paco Bell, so that's great.
Yeah, and we should assure our listeners that after you get married, we won't announce it before you get married, but after the ceremony does take place, we'll have to tell our listeners what you ended up choosing.
The entire playlist is going to go on our mixtape.
maybe the classical mixtape is going to be the playlist. Who knows?
That is a thought. But I do really appreciate everybody responding to my call for suggestions for my wedding. This is really awesome.
Okay, Tiffany, why don't you read some more? This is more from Chuck's email here.
Yeah, so Chuck goes on to have a really interesting point, actually. So Chuck points out, specifically on the topic of the Today's Office posts, listeners may recall that a couple episodes ago, we sort of made fun of the stereotypical assistant conductor, if you will, post from the audience chairs to the stage with the whole orchestra on. In the middle of a rehearsal and saying, this is my office today. And I sort of poked fun at that as kind of one of my least favorite phenomena on the social media sphere. Chuck says, I must admit I am guilty of making these posts, specifically as a horn player. Southern California has two great Facebook groups where gigs are regularly posted. I had multiple people who said they chose who to hire for their gig based on the content of their own page. Meaning, if you post a lot of photos of yourself doing other gigs or the classic music on the stand looking out into the hall photo, you are more likely to get gigs. I had not thought of this at all, and it like still reads as kind of nuts to me. What do you guys think?
I think there's some truth in that, but I also know that of a few instances in which this kind of thing works against you too, where, you know, if you're a substitute player or someone that is kind of freelancing and they're oversharing like what things they're doing, contractors will notice this, and actually it might work against you too. So I think it depends on where you are of all this. But at the same time, you know, like as a conductor that guest conducts a lot, I sometimes have like feel like I need to show that I am active and I'm traveling and working with orchestras, certainly.
Yeah, and that you appreciate the, you know, the world that you live in. I mean, I know that we're sort of, everyone kind of struggles to deal with how to manage social media in their own way. And so by, you know, by concession to Chuck, which I admit, like, you know, you want to get gigs, like you want work and you want to show people you appreciate what they do. And of course, it can work in the opposite direction, to which I just say, okay, everybody, you do you, and whatever makes you happy, just do it.
Yeah, and I just want to clarify my point from that episode, which is that I fully endorse people sharing their professional activities on social media. I think it's great. I like to know what my friends are up to. Like, I really enjoy a lot of those posts. Where I make the distinction is, the posts where you show what you're working on, whom you're working with, you know, the great time that you had, the colleagues that you connected with or reconnected with, that's great. I mean, I find that like kind of heartwarming. What I don't like is the lifestyle porn.
It's the cigar and the whiskey, right? Is that what you said?
The lifestyle porn of a certain kind of dude bro conductor who is, you know, laying out on the beach and has the score open. It's like, bro, you're not studying your score. Like, if you want to show me the picture of you studying your score, like, show me, like, the eraser detritus, you know, lining your desk. And, you know, you have to get out your dustbuster to, like, clean it all up. And, like, show me where you have, like, five different pencils down to a nub. And, like, you're singing something you can't get to sleep because it's, you know, taking your soul away from you. The cigar and the bourbon and stuff. Like, no, that's not what conducting, that's not what studying a score is like for a conductor or preparing your part or whatever. So that is what gets me, that's what gets my goat.
Okay, listeners, you have your mission. Like, Instagram post with those five elements in it, tag Will White.
Yeah, always tag Will if you're gonna do these posts now. Let's just over tag Will on all of these posts.
Okay, we're gonna get more into our grab bag here. Kensho, why don't you take the next piece of feedback that we've gotten here?
Great. So this is a comment from Michaela. Thank you, Michaela, for writing in. She writes, "Thank you for creating this podcast, witty and informative. It has been a while since I played a live concert or socialized with any of my musician friends. I love to feel that I'm sitting around gabbing about music. So far, my favorites have been the 600-year organ concert and the spooky Berlioz performance. Have been enjoying the YouTube playlist as well." Well, there's one person that's a fan of the 600-year organ concert there.
Yeah, right. Yeah. We should have posted on our social media like the would you rather about the 1,000 recorders or the organ concert.
That's a great idea.
Maybe we can. Hey, you know, never too late. First of all, I mean, I'm so glad that people are feeling a sense of connection to us in this time when we are all so disconnected. And then the other thing that I just want to mention is Michaela's last little sentence there, that she's been enjoying the YouTube playlist. And I just want to remind everybody that our classical mixtape playlist is a real thing. I do update it every week with our new classical mixtape videos. You know, it's all on YouTube, how we work. So sometimes people have told me, like, oh, you know, Will, what was that thing that, you know, that Kensho said that he was listening to last week? I'm like, hey, folks, look it up on the playlist. It's all there. You know, just lay back, sit back and enjoy the ride. So I did want to point that out. And thanks. I'm so glad that Michaela is enjoying that.
Thanks, Michaela. Will, you want to take this next one?
Yeah, sure. This comes from listener Megzy, who also wrote us an email. She says, "Dear GabFest, I have really enjoyed the classical GabFest so far. You all have unique insights, and I feel like I'm listening in on a fun conversation among the cool music theory experts."
Can we just like acknowledge the irony of the word cool, like mutant reference to us?
I know. I mean, just that's probably the first time that any of us have ever been called cool or an expert. So, Megzy, thank you so much. "Though the whole podcast is a joy, I really love hearing what pieces each of you are enjoying that week, and I love that you put the info in the show notes." So that's another thing that I would mention is that, you know, the show notes are pretty detailed. And for right now, that is kind of the home of all of the information about the podcast. It's deep in the show notes. Megzy continues, "I wholeheartedly agree with your assessment of the existential crisis that classical music has about its older audiences. orchestras should really be asking themselves, how can we be relevant to our communities? That was Kensho's big point from that last episode where we were talking about age and classical music. She then continues, one thing I would like to hear about is a review of how orchestras have changed policies following the Black Lives Matter protests this year. I know a few orchestras have had mediated discussions, etc., but what has changed? What are orchestras still struggling with? Thank you for opening up my world of classical experience and treating us to your wisdom and occasional delicious pettiness.
We're really good at that.
Yeah, what do you guys think? Well, first of all, what do you think of that characterization of us, wise and deliciously petty? Do you agree with that?
Are we all collectively wise and deliciously petty, or are just some of us wise and some of us deliciously petty, Will?
That's for the listeners to decide. And what about this question about what is actually changing in orchestras? You know, I was thinking about this, like, we sort of have this interregnum now where nobody's doing regular concerts. Do you think that when we come back from the quarantine period, do you think that things really are going to be changed? Do you think that the momentum is going to be sustained in orchestral programming or any kind of classical music programming?
This is my biggest fear, is that this becomes yet another initiative that is not sustained. And I think it's an important question that we need to be continuously asking ourselves in the pandemic and after the pandemic and forever on.
Yeah, this is a scary prospect, right? And like, there are any number of times things that are going to come forward as concerns, namely the concern of what if it doesn't fill the hall, or these kinds of, right, like the things that have resulted in the pre-COVID, pre-George Floyd, conservatism that controls a lot of orchestral programming. And it's really difficult to say what will and won't change. We certainly can't assess now what things have stuck. I mean, it's still way too early, even if it weren't COVID. I bet that if it weren't COVID, that orchestras would have been in a hurry to revise this current season that we are in, 2021 season, to be able to be more racially inclusive. And what I'm not sure of is how robust that change will have proven in, we'll say, 5 years. I mean, I think that it's worth looking that far out to see whether something is actually like taking root or not. And that may even be a little on the conservative side because, you know, who knows what's going to happen in the next 2 years.
I got to say, I'm a little bit more hopeful than the two of you because I think that the advantage to this quarantine period is that everything was totally scrambled and had to be reassembled from scratch. You know, none of the plans for this season could go forward as scheduled. And because of that, there was a lot of freedom. I mean, this is what we were talking with Garrett McQueen about, was like how do institutions respond on the turn of a dime. And the fact that there has been this increased emphasis in online content is, I think, a way that orchestras and other organizations are training their audiences to listen for and expect a little bit of a different outlook in the programming. So I actually think that this is something that can be sustained, and I'm hopeful that it will happen. All right, Tiffany, do you want to do the next comment here?
So our next comment comes from Eric via Instagram, and this is one of my favorite comments that we've gotten since starting this podcast. He says, listening to all of you play the limbo game was like watching Roger Federer hit from a tennis ball machine. Next time, the options should be 1 second or 0 seconds.
So this is in reference to the listening limbo game with the violin concertos and then the Rossini overture. And what was the second option?
Stravinsky ballets.
Stravinsky ballets, right. Yeah, that was a fun one. I can't wait to be the host for that game, just to see the wagering. Because I think that's the wagers are kind of the fun part, right, in terms of the mind games that can be played.
Right, and we should sort of tease the fact that we've added another game theory element. Tiffany is big into game design and game theory, so there will be something that's going to make the wagering even more interesting the next time that we play Listening Limbo.
Which is everyone's favorite game?
Oh, I think it's everyone's favorite game, yeah, for sure.
Just like the rest of them, right? Okay, well, I'm here for it. I love Drop the Needle games. It's like absolutely my favorite. Okay, Kensho, why don't you take this next one?
All right, so this one is coming from Ellen. She writes, this is rapidly becoming one of my very favorite podcasts. It's got a great mix of high-end gossip, nerdy musical stuff, and things of general interest to almost anyone who loves music. I've come to trust the host's opinions, wow, and depth of knowledge. So I'm just shocked at that anyone would trust my opinion. And depth of knowledge, also very surprising. So I'd as soon find out things from them rather than navigating my way through many of the topics they treat. I really appreciated finding out about the firing of Garrett McQueen and getting to hear him interviewed. I had somehow missed the whole incident, which is really important for people to know about.
Yeah, thank you, Ellen. And, Garrett was our first guest, and we've since had a few more, and we've got a few more lined up. But that's another thing that we'd love listener feedback about, is whom do you want us to feature on this show? So, so far the guests have been fantastic. They've been really fun to talk to. But we know that there are other great people out there who might not be on our radar screen. So that would be really helpful. But Ellen, we're all really glad that you're enjoying the podcast.
Yes, thanks so much, Ellen, and thanks again to everyone who's written in. Please, listeners, if you've got feedback for us, whether it's something we got right, something we got wrong, a topic or guest suggestions or anything else, please email them to us at classicalgapfest@gmail.com or find us on social media. Will, would you like to take us into our final segment for today?
Sure. Earlier this summer, concerning rumors started bubbling up in the classical music sphere about a major COVID outbreak among the dancers and orchestra musicians of the Mariinsky Theater in St. Petersburg. These rumors were firmly reported out by Alex Marshall in the New York Times in an article on August 20th. Marshall reported that, after having resumed its activities on a very limited basis in May, the Mariinsky felt emboldened enough to up its ballet class sizes to 30 dancers in August. Then, just 2 weeks later, on August 13th, all performances and classes were canceled after approximately 30 people in the company tested positive for COVID. Perhaps even more concerning in light of this revelation was the fact that the company's artistic director, Valery Gergiev, decided to go forward with a planned national tour of the Mariinsky Orchestra on August 17th, a decision that has been criticized as irresponsible. This, of course, comes in the context of Russia's president, Vladimir Putin, a close associate of Gergiev's, declaring the battle against the coronavirus, quote-unquote, won, and approving the world's first coronavirus vaccine before the completion of clinical trials. This story touches on a number of complicated topics involving the interplay of politics and art, and particularly of the Russian state's relationship to Russia's culture and cultural institutions. So I thought that we might start there. Tiffany, can you flesh out a little bit for us, what is the role of fine arts in Russia? How does it compare with what we would think of as being the role of a ballet company or an opera house or an orchestra in the United States? What do you think about that?
We're fond of making comparisons between what would happen if the arts didn't have to just be commercially viable and if it had a sort of state-sponsored cachet that would allow it to be somehow freer of needing to, meet the bottom line in order just to exist, which is the system that we have here, more or less. I mean, there is obviously NEA and these kinds of other governmental structures that are meant to boost the arts, but there's nowhere close to as what exists in terms of scale across the Atlantic. And so this gets into some really interesting territory as what is a cultural institution that is basically beholden to the state to do other than represent the state, which is the kind of philosophical dissonance that we have with that idea, I think, as Americans. The Mariinsky is a great example of this, which is to say that it is the juggernaut of the arts of the performing arts in Russia. And its glory equals Russia's glory in a very intimate sense. So when you have this relationship between the state and an outlet, and we'll classify it as kind of an entertainment or even like a media outlet in a way, right? Then what do you have to be aware of when that's happening? And that's a complex question.
Right. And I think that this is really the double-edged sword of this whole situation, is that when you are a government sponsored organization and your employees are civil servants, then the organization itself can be wielded as a political tool, as I think it may very well have been in this situation. I mean, we all think that we would like to have more support for the arts in the United States, but if that meant that Donald Trump could make the National Symphony play a sold-out...
America,
you know,
the Beautiful.
Yeah, America the Beautiful.
For
right,
Dinesh D'Souza.
For Dinesh D'Souza, or at a big rally or something like that. Would we want that? I don't think so. Yeah. I mean, obviously, yeah, there is a middle ground that I think is something that we would all strive for. Well, I wanted to single out one quote from this article in the New York Times. And this was actually a principal dancer at the Mariinsky who said this, and who happens to be a British gentleman. And he said that the Mariinsky had received a lot of flack on social media for returning too soon, but he didn't think that this was fair. The ballet had taken every measure it could. And if you do read the article, it was a very socially distanced program that they were doing. It was just a couple dancers to start out with, and then things got out of hand when they increased the class sizes again. But he says, and those same people are saying we should wait 2 years to get back on stage. That's ridiculous. A dancer's career is 20 years. Did that raise any eyebrows for you guys?
Well, they're making the same bet that a lot of us are making when we go out to eat now. You know, we do it outdoors. We kind of assume that we're not going to die from it. I think that's the same bet that they're making. And like what he's saying is that a 10% cut to the length of your career is not just something to be like, oh, well, whatever, you know, like, I guess we can't do that now. They're betting that they can, in fact, do it. And I'm so curious, do we have ballet dancer listeners out there? Can you tell us whether there are inherently, like, more or fewer dangers? Like, I don't know anything about the science of, like, dancing and COVID.
Well, I would have to imagine that, you know, when you're dancing, you are... It's an athletic pursuit. I mean, these are athletes,
right,
you know, and they're in a closed space.
Yeah. But I don't think that this is so far afield. For example, I mean, like, baseball's resumed here, you know, like the players wear masks sometimes when they're in the dugout, but they're not wearing them when they're on the field.
Yeah, but they're spread out by, like, well, Kencho can tell us more about that. I don't know anything about baseball.
Well, but we're talking about...
There's contact in baseball.
Yeah, and speaking of contact, like, contact, the NFL is going on, and there have been a number of COVID clusters popping up here and there, and they've had to postpone games and stuff, obviously, when people are tackling each other. So,
I mean, this is so interesting. We're discussing the cultural cachet of the arts to Russia. If there is a comparison in American culture, it's sports. How far are we willing to go before we're willing to throw out sports seasons altogether? If there is one institution in this country that I think is, like, absolutely emblematic of what we as a culture are willing to accept or call acceptable risk, it is our sports industry. And so this is not very different, I think, and the fact that also that our president has seen fit to weigh in on the functioning of sports, I think, speaks to this as well, right?
Well, with that, I think that's a great point to wrap up on. You know, this is a concerning topic, but we hope for the best for everybody who does work at the Mariinsky, and we hope that their tour and their performances have not caused any more outbreaks. All right, with that, I think it's time for our classical mixtape. Kencho.
In our classical mixtape, we each recommend some music that's caught our ear this week to share with our listeners. So, Tiffany, what do you have for us this week?
I'm going to recommend a piece called Kikimora by Anatoly Liadov. This is a composer who was working in Russia in the late 19th, early 20th century. And I think one of his claims to fame is that the Firebird Commission would have been his, except he got lazy. But he actually did write a couple really fun orchestral tone poems. And I'm going to recommend this one again, Kikimora, which is a legendary creature in Slavic mythology, which is this kind of a bad spirit that lives behind the stove or in the cellar and produces, like, creepy little noises. And so this tone poem is actually, I mean, for me, it reads like kind of an interesting mix of, like, Sorcerer's Apprentice and maybe, like, a little bit of Franck. So I find it really quite charming.
Thank you.
So, Tiffany, which came first, this Kikimora piece or Dukaz the Sorcerer Apprentice?
You know, it's an interesting question, and before I looked it up, there's no way listening to these two pieces that I would have been able to tell. But the chronology is Sorcerer's Apprentice comes out in 1897, and then Kikimora, Liadov's Opus 63, comes out 1909. The recording of this I'm going to recommend is, you can find it right on YouTube, it's the USSR State Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Evgeny Svetlanov.
All right, thank you, Tiffany. Will, what is your suggestion for this week?
This is a piece that I stumbled on in one of my many epic clicking adventures in YouTube. It's a piece by a Ukrainian composer named Boris Lyatoshinsky, and it's his second piano trio, Opus 41. And I'm recommending the first movement, but in reality, I'm recommending the whole thing. It's a very cool piece of music. You know, Lyatoshinsky is one of these many Soviet composers who were just writing very solid music in the first part of the 20th century, but, you know, only a small handful of them have trickled through the filter of history. But I really enjoyed this piece. I enjoy some of his symphonic works that I've found. It's just the more that I listen to him, the more that I like him.
Thank you, Will. So I've brought a piece that ties in some things from our earlier topics. I am bringing the Piano Quintet Opus 1 by Ernst von Dohnányi. And this is a piece that I actually played at the International Music Festival in Pilsen on viola. And I am not recommending the first movement. I am actually recommending the third movement, which is the slow movement, which begins with a gorgeous viola solo that I fell in love with instantly after learning this piece. This is one of those pieces that I turn to, especially around this time of year, like fall, when it starts to get a little cold, and the amount of kind of deliciously cheesy moments in this entire piece is great, but I think the third movement is a really great highlight of all of those wonderful moments.
Can I just make an appeal to our listeners to also send us your fall mood takes, because I find myself compiling like seasonal lists at this time of year as well, like things that just remind me of the feeling when the leaves start to turn. So send us your takes on that.
Well, you know, Kenshiro, I'm not going to argue with any recommendation of a great viola solo piece, so I welcome this. It's not a piece I'm familiar with at all, so I can't wait to listen to it.
After bickering with you all these classical mixtapes, I thought I'd throw you a bone. And this particular recording is performed by Andras Schiff and the Takash Quartet. You'll find the links to all these and to our full classical mixtape playlist in the show notes.
And with that, it's time to wrap up this episode of the Classical Gabfest. I'm Tiffany Liu, and on behalf of Kensho Watanabe and William White, I'd like to thank you so much for listening and to encourage you to subscribe and rate us on Apple Podcasts. We also love your help spreading the word about the show on social media. You can find us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. You can reach us at classicalgabfest@gmail.com, and we'd love to hear from you. Until next time, happy listening, and we will be with you next week.